I'd like to introduce Andres Arranz and welcome you to the NEVO Extension Closeout presentation. So NEVO is one of our Work Package E projects, which is looking at new approaches to demand capacity balancing. And it started off actually with a workshop with airlines and ANSPs and other operational experts, where these new approaches have been identified. So the airline people said, why don't you prioritize flights that go into a hub, or why don't you prioritize flights that have various legs to come, and so on and so on. There was a list of 20 or so approaches that were tested in a network model that NEVO has built up for that. And it actually turned out that none of these approaches did any better than first come, first serve, with the exception perhaps of most capable, best served. And in order to study most capable, best served in a little more detail, we extended the project. And we said, please, in this project extension, look at most capable, best served and the effect it may have on the network performance in terms of delay and capacity and all the rest of it. Please also increase the number of, or the percentage of, equipped aircraft throughout the study in order to see, is there a cutoff point, is there a point where it actually starts showing significant effects. Previous studies have suggested that if you have less than 30 or 50% of equipped aircraft in your network, then effects don't show, so increase the equipage. But please also look at different airline types, so look at low-cost carriers, look at legacy carriers, etc., and maybe use different equipage levels for these. Okay. And this is what actually Andres and his team have done in this study. So, please.
So, thank you, Dave, for the presentation. As Dirk has explained, the NEVO extension project was a spin-off of the NEVO project. Among all the prioritization criteria we studied, the most capable of a service strategy was the one who demonstrated to be the most promising. So this is the reason why we extend the project and do this study. This study starts from the idea that although some airlines are investing in advanced equipage and advanced training for the crew, ground systems and staff in ground are not prepared yet to provide them any technical advantage. So is there any way to reward them, for example, with an operational advantage, with departure precedence, or reducing them the viability or the separation, to encourage this kind of investments for the early adopters? The global aim, as I told you, to reinforce with this empirical data of this study, the assumption that giving departure priority to airlines which are investing yet in advanced capabilities gives them an operational benefit without affecting the global behavior of the network. So to give them precedence or to give them priority does not affect the behavior of the network and the rest of the airlines. So the two simulation objectives were to identify the threshold from these operational benefits are obtained and to assess at a global level which is the effect on the network performance. This was the project methodology. It's a small project, very simple. We first, in parallel, we identify the changes we need to do to the model, because this is based on a tool that we developed for the all new project. First, we identify the changes we need to do to this tool, and in parallel, we develop the experimental plan. Then we do all the work of adapt the model to this new study, and then after to do the simulations, we analyze the results. The operational context of the project is that we try to simulate, or we simulate the whole ECAC-wide area. The input traffic sample is flown traffic. This is important because it's not planned data, it's flown traffic with estimated data in the ECAC area in 2 days of April of 2014, more or less composed of 40,860 flights after the cleaning of the data, because some of the data are not good for the simulation. We consider air traffic as a network, considering the airports as nodes. These airports has capacity restrictions, so they are supposed to have only the flights that are permitted with this capacity. And the edges, or the lines who join two nodes, are the routes of the traffic of the aircraft. The network operation plan derived from the traffic sample is the reference for do the planning and the execution of the operations. The assumptions and simplifications we use is that airports are thousands or trains of aircraft, and they are characterized by the nominal capacities. We extract the nominal capacities from the airport corner and this kind of source of data. For the small airports, we use a capacity of 30 flights per hour. The parking capacity on ground is considered infinite, so the limiting factor of the capacity is the runway capacity. We do not go through the parking capacity. The uncertainty on the airport's operations, and not only in the airports, also on route, is considered through uncertainty parameters, so through internal disturbance. We will explain in detail after that, associated with the departure and arrivals. We take into account the reactionary delays because we link the arrivals and departures only based on the aircraft. We link if they have the same regulation. If not, we have developed an algorithm to link the flights based on the origin, destination, time of flight, and company or airline, and this kind of thing. We do not consider space structures and their management. We assume that according to CESAR concept, it will create sufficient terminal area and route capacity, and this will not be no longer a constraint. So we assume that free route is on, and the route are calculated from the scheduled time flight, or the time on the air. The modeling approach is we use a mathematical model. It's a dynamic and stochastic simulation model with a mesoscopic approach. The main features are that the traffic is dynamically adapted to the capacity constraints. The level of granularity of the air traffic management rules can be customized. It incorporates uncertainty associated to the ATM and air complexity, and has a coarse level of detail. It's only modeling the fundamental aspects of the ATM systems. As I told you, we do not go through the trajectories or routes and these kind of things. There are two model phases. The simulation is divided into two phases. First one is a planning phase. The outcome of this phase is a balance between capacity and demand. The output is that network operation plan that with all the capacity and demand balance. This is an input for the second phase, the execution phase, as well as the internal disturbance and, in some cases, external disturbance. We apply these disturbances and unbalance the sample or the plan, and then apply the prioritization to see how is the delay propagation and to check the results. It's important to see that we apply the prioritization two times, one here in the planification phase and another time in the execution phase after applying the disturbance. After I unbalance the network or unbalance the sample, we apply again the prioritization. So the first part of the planning phase is data loading. We load the data and we create two data structures that we will use through the simulation. Airports, that basically has all the database of the airport with its location and its capacity, nominal capacity, that could be reduced in some scenarios, we will see. And network operations plans, that are basically the list of flights with all the relationship between them, where they're linked, and all these data attributes, estimated takeoff time, estimated off-off time, flight duration, everything. We treat the data to remove erroneous input data and to improve the quality of the information. We found some data that are not correct, for example, simultaneous flight with the same regulation plate, flights that are on the air and on ground at the same time, and so we have to remove or treat all this data to trying to not lose a lot of flights. And we also, as I told you, develop an algorithm to link flights in case that we cannot have the complete chain because we don't have the regulation of some flight. This is very important because all the reactionary delays are calculated and using this thing. The second part of the planning phase, we calculate the empirical delay parameters to model the internal disturbance based on the traffic sample. These parameters are then used in the execution phase. We use four parameters. First one is applied to the turnaround phase, is calculated as the difference between actual of block time and estimated of block time. And at the end, the result was a non-parametric distribution. As an example is represented here. We try to fix to a number of normal distribution or T student or these kind of things. We find that the best fit was with a non-parametric distribution. And these were used afterwards in the execution phase to apply this internal disturbance. The second parameter, A2, is the parameter to model the taxi out phase. It's represented as the difference between the taxi times, between actual and estimated. After examining the data, we realize that this is calculated only for the airports where actual taxi time is different than estimated taxi time, because we realize that although this data are flown data, only in airports where fume is sent to Eurocontrol, these data are valid. In the rest of the airports, the ATT and, ATT and ETT are the same, so this is a problem of the quality of the data. And again, was modeled as a non-parametric distribution.
FUM is the flight upload message.
Flight update message that, that is sent by the CDM, not all, but majority of the CDM airports to Eurocontrol. This is a cross-check that we did after that. So it was not advised at the beginning when we received the data sample. B1 is the parameter that accounts for the disturbances in the flying phase. Is the difference between the flying time, actual and estimated flying time. And C1 is the parameter for the taxiing phase. Since we do not have the empirical data, because we only have the actual time of arrival and estimated time of arrival, we do not calculate from the sample. We decide to use the 63 minutes average primary delay in Europe according to the COTA digest for quarter three of 2014 and rest A2 and B1, which are the other parameters, and calculate C1 from there. Last step of this planning phase is the definition of the initial condition. We select the exercise that we are going to model, we introduce external disturbance in case they are applied, and we create and cancel flights because there's a number of flights created and canceled randomly in each run of the simulation, a very small percentage. The last part of the planning phase is to balance demand and the capacity. Flights are ordered and distributed in the slots. Here, the notion of a slot is not the same as in ATM. Slot is for the model, the time window that we consider. It's not an ATFM slot according to capacity. And these are the criteria we use to order the flights. First, we put the flight in the air for safety reasons. Flights which are in the air will always have precedence over flights which still remain on ground. This criteria is not affecting this phase, it's only for the execution phase. Then flights with X in the flight type field. We consider that these are special flights like head of state, ambulance, or special status that they have precedence over any other. Then we identify as capable. I will tell you afterwards how we have identified or characterized the flight as capable, and then the rest of the flights. And we distribute our time steps to have the output of demand and capacity balance. Then it starts the execution phase. When this demand and capacity has been balanced, the model starts to process and evolve all the flights. The initial state is all the flights are on the ground. From this point, at the parameter time before the planned departure, capacity is checked in departure and destination airport, not only in departure. If there is room in both, the aircraft takes off. If not, the program or the model looks for a new available time window to locate this aircraft. This checking of the capacity in departure and destination airports only happens in internal flights. For flights coming from outside the ECAC area, the capacity is not checked when it departs. This is something that we confirm with the network manager. They receive the flights and do not check if there is room in the destination airport. At each aircraft rotation, we introduce all the delays stochastically in the flights as an internal disturbance. This is a representation of the internal disturbance I have explained before. And once the flight is landed, if there is no link to another one, the process is over for this flight. If there is, the process continues with another flight, applying again the stochastic delays and so on and so on. Apart from giving priority to the capable flight in the planification and the execution phase, these two performance benefits have been included also in the model for the capable flights. We assume that the variability of the capable flights is reduced, is tuned for the best. So the variability of this internal disturbance parameter is reduced for the capable flights, not for the rest, only for these capable flights. And we assume that as these flights are capable, they will improve the efficiency in the arrival flow. So capable flights will always have a guaranteed arrival slots, even in the situations where the demand is over the capacity. How we model this? We apply an extra 10% of capacity to the airports, only for capable flights, for arrival capable flights, if they're on the air and the airport is congested. All these effects have been applied at the same time in the simulation. So it's we will see after that that it's very difficult to discriminate which is the consequence of each effect at the, after the simulation, because all of them has been applied all the times. The indicators and metrics that we have used, we measure all these indicators. The percentage of delayed flights, where the difference between the final time and the requested time is bigger than 5 minutes. The average delay per flight, taking into consideration all the flights. the congestion indicator, or the percentage of time where the demand in an airport is higher than 80% of the nominal capacity, the average delay of delayed flights, basically the same indicator than the average delay, but only taking into account the delayed flights, the global delay, the sum of all the delays in one run, because we did a lot of runs for each exercise, the number of flights that we move in the simulation, more than 5 minutes from its original time, from its requested time, and the distribution of the delays among capable and non-capable flights. And these are the difference between the old NEWO model or NEWO approach and the NEWO extension. In NEWO, the external disturbance are calculated from statistical data, from the data from CODA, and are applied in one single parameter. We calculate here the internal disturbance from the sample, and we applied four different parameters in different times in the simulations. We only consider 133 airports. We do not consider the small airports in Europe. Here we consider all the airports in the area. The old NEWO has only 1 day of simulation. We use here 2 days of simulation, almost double of flights. The only performance benefit included here was the prioritization of flights according to different rules or criteria. We use the prioritization of flights, but besides the performance benefit, as I have explained, in NEWO, diversions are not considered. Here in NEWO extension, we consider diversions, applying some rules when the original destination airport is congested, and after a parameter time, I think it was 3 hours, we consider that the flight could divert to a less congested airport, and then this flight is counting for the capacity of the diverted airport. As I told you, the internal disturbance are applied as an aggregated parameter before the execution phase. We manage here the internal disturbance as 4 different parameters in different time of the simulation, not at the same time all. The modeling approach in NEWO was based on time events, so the simulation is advancing on time and doing different things. We change here the modeling approach and we center on the flights. We are following a flight all during its life cycle and look at what are the effects on them. In the original model of NEWO, we only take into account the departure slot for let a flight take off. In NEWO extension, we check if there's room in departure and destination aerodrome to let the aircraft fly. So the experiment plan is also divided in 2 phases. First one is nominal conditions. We study 6 scenarios with increasing percentage of capable aircraft, starting from first come, first serve, non-capable aircraft, until the last scenario, that is 70% of capable aircraft. And we calculate indicators for the global network per group of aircrafts and also per airline. And in phase 2, we simulate 2 exercises. One is an earthquake alert in Turkey. We assume that all the Turkish airports are closed by 2 hours. The second one is an air traffic control failure in London area. And we assume that the nominal capacity of 6 main airports are cut off 50% during 8 hours. The only way that we have to simulate this external disturbance is by reducing the capacity of the airports during a limited period of time. For the simulation, we use Monte Carlo simulations, repeating each simulation run a significant number of times. And this is the formula we use to calculate the number of runs to be statistically significant. The main issue here is how we characterize the aircraft as capable. We do not any hint from the traffic sample which aircraft are capable or not. So we have to simulate that. We consider the capability as an attribute, as a flag. So there is no different degrees of capability. The aircraft is capable or is not capable. It's not a degree of capability. First, we divide the flights in groups based on the flight type on the flight plan, and we have 5 groups. So regional flights, or flights belonging to regional airlines, flights belonging to regular airlines, flights of charter, flights belonging to low-cost or point-to-point airlines, and Group E, rest of the flights, private airlines, taxis, this kind of things. Then we assign airlines to subgroups, because we will use it afterwards in the simulation. The only rule here is that the number of flights per subgroup will be approximately the same, and we do not split airlines. So one airline belongs to one subgroup or another. As you can see, we have 2 samples because we have 2 groups of data, and the number of flights are very similar in both, or in all these subgroups. The third step was to assign the capability percentage to subgroups. And the final result, all the scenarios as I've been mentioning before. The first scenario is first come, first serve, no capability or no aircraft capable assigned. The second scenario is have a total of 18% of capable aircraft. third scenario 33%, fourth scenario etc. 50%, until five that has a 72% of capable aircraft. The only special consideration that we have here, we use three percentages, 0, 33, 66, or 100% of each subgroup. For charter flights, we only consider two values, 0 and 33. For the rest of, and for group E, that is the private airlines, we don't consider them as capable never. And for the rest of the groups, the percentages are divided among them. Then we will start to discuss a little bit about the simulation results. First, we will start with the global results, the percentage of departure and arrival delay flights. As we can see, the departure and arrival delay flights are very similar in all the exercises. The results for Faircon, Faircerva, and the rest of exercises very, very low. I don't know if you could see, but in all the graphs are the same. Red are the non-capable flights, blue are the capable flights, and green are all the flights. So the whole sample. Normally we used to represent in abscisses the exercise. We put all the exercise in the same graph, and here the time or the percentage or the variable represented. In terms of this indicator, we don't see any relationship between the rise of the percentage of capable flights and the percentage of flights departing or arriving on time. So the distribution is more or less the same. If we look at the average departure arrival delay per flight and per delay flights, the results are not the same. As you could see, the best global results are for the exercise 3, 4, and 5, that are the ones with more capable flights. From exercise 3 is 50%, exercise 4 is 66%, and exercise 5 is 72%, but they are very similar, 3.7 in all of them, for example, for this indicator. And the results always improve the results of the first conferser, that is 4.8 in this case and 16.8 in this case. So we are improving the network performance looking at these indicators. If we see the number of flights move forward or backwards more than 5 minutes, we could see that the percentage of not moved flights remains the same in all the exercises, it's constant. But curiously, the proportion between the total capable flights and not capable flights and those what have been moved are constant in all the exercises. You could see here that these lines represent the total capable flights and the total non-capable flights. This is the green is capable, the purple is non-capable, and this is the number of capable move and non-capable move, and the figures are exactly the same but smaller. This is an important issue because here we have the effect of the planning and the execution phases. The more important thing is that looking at this part of the graphic is the planning phase, this part of the graphic is the execution phase. The distribution of the delay between the planning phase, where we only apply the prioritization, and the execution phase, where also the extra capacity and the internal disturbance are applied. We could see, if we look at the global results at the green columns, that always at the planning phase we obtain the same result when the sample is balanced. This could be explained because, as I told you before, we start from flown traffic, not from planned traffic, so probably this traffic is yet well balanced. And there is more influence in the execution phase on delay for exercise 1 and 2. We could see here the difference between, in exercise 1, the difference between capable and global delays and the amount in the execution phase. Here we pass from 4/10 of difference to almost 2 points, but in exercise 3, for example, we pass from 5/10 to 7/10. So more influence in the execution phase for delays in exercise 1 and 2, where there are less capable flights. If we look at the percentage of departure delay minutes, global departure delay minutes, looking at the variation between exercises, we see that we are reducing the departure delay minutes, the global delay minutes, until exercise 3, and then this is maintained. So we do not obtain improvements after exercise 3, that is the one with 50% approximately of capable flights. Looking at the congestion indicator, this is only a representation of one of the exercises because all of them are very similar. this try to represent proportionally the amount of time that an airport is congested. As we could see, the most congested areas are the area of Istanbul and Turkey, and the ones in London Heathrow, Gatwick, and the London area, basically. The distribution of delays between capable and non-capable, the thing here is we could observe that in all the graphs, the percentage in the distribution of delays is always 10 to 15 points lower, percentual points lower than the distribution of capable and non-capable flights. For example, exercise 2, which has a 33% of capable aircraft, has a 21% of delay corresponding to capable flights. Exercise 3, which has 50, has 34% of delay corresponding to capable flights. Looking at the result for the group of airlines, here we have the four groups represented in the same line. This one is the blue line is the regional airlines, red line are the regulars, green is charters, and purple is low cost. We see that for the regional airlines, the best results are in the last two exercises, where they have their highest capability percentage of aircrafts. For regular flights, the best performance happens in exercise 3, where there is not the biggest number of capable aircraft of this group, but is the maximum percentage of capable aircraft if we compare with the rest. Charter flights, which only represent 4% of the flights, has a very constant behavior. And for low-cost flight, the relative gain in exercise with higher percentage of capable flights that are 4 and 5 is small compared with the gain in the other groups. This could be due to the dispersion of the flights throughout the network. They are not concentrated in the same area, so at the end the gain is not very significant. Going to results by subgroup, as I told you, the divisions that we made on these groups have more or less the same number of flights. In the regional island, we see that the ones with a higher departure average, one thing here you can see which is the relative percentage of the capable flights in each of the subgroups. So for regional airlines, we see that the ones with higher average departure delays and the prioritization of capable flights have not big impact in the performance, because in those cases we only obtain 2 minutes almost 100% of capable flights. In this case, we obtain only 2 minutes of improvement. For charter airlines, we have a limitation that is the percentage is not bigger than 33 never. So, and as we could see, we are moving in tenths of minutes. For regular airlines, the regular airline results are conditioned because in the subgroup B2, which is the red line, is included Turkish Airlines. It's operating at a very congested area, and in the exercise where this group B2 has a 100% of capable aircraft, the results are very, very improved from the beginning. For low-cost airlines, D1 group is not affected by the prioritization criteria or by the improvement. D1 is the blue one, but D2 is more reactive to the prioritization. Some of the airlines in D2 are, for example, EasyJet, Air Berlin, Germanwings, Pegasus or Wizz Air, and in D1 is Ryanair is the main one. We have selected some specific airlines to analyze the effects in the performance. For example, for Ryanair Airlines, what we try to do is to select airlines with a number of operations similar in the sample. For example, here we select one airline based on Ireland and one airline based on Turkey. The Irish is the blue one, the Turkey is the red one. The two airlines start from very different situations. The Turkish one starts from a very heavy, from having very heavy delays in the first come first serve, and have a good improvement when we reach a percentage of capability over 100% or 66% in these two exercises. In comparison, the other airline, the Irish one, starts from a best position and his performance is almost constant and irrespective of the capability percentage. For the regular ones, we select SAS, which is the green line, British Airways, which is the purple, and Air France, which is the blue line. Operating in very different areas, SAS is operating in Scandinavia, a great number of domestic flights, a less congested area. British Airways has two bases in very congested airports, London Heathrow and Gatwick, and Air France does not have a so congested situation. The situation for SAS and Air France is very stable, irrespective of the capability percentage, but British Airways improved the minimum delay in almost 4 minutes in the exercise where it has the 100% of capable flights with respect to first come, first serve. For charter airlines, as I told you, there are very low numbers, not very representative, but we have also included. We use TUI Fly based on Germany and Jet Air Fly based on Belgium. TUI is more sensitive to the prioritization criteria than Jet. One possible explanation is that the higher the average delay, the higher the response to the prioritization. But as I told you, the sample is so small that it's difficult to extract any conclusion. And for the low-cost airlines, we have chosen Norwegian and Air Berlin. The two airlines have different behaviors, but all of them, or both, have the better result when they have 100% of capable flights. And they need a high percentage of capable flights to take advantage of this prioritization. So with a low number or low percentage of capable flights, they don't have any improvements. Looking at the results by airport, we have analyzed three different airports: Istanbul, which is a very congested one, London Heathrow, and Madrid, which starts from better position at the beginning. As we can see in Istanbul, the average delay improves dramatically for the capable flights from the beginning. We reduce here the delay from 21 minutes to 2 minutes for capable flights. This could be due to the extra 10% of capacity for capable flights. The best value for the average delay occurs in the exercise 3, but at the risk of penalizing a lot the non-capable flights. This could be due that the Turkish belongs to B2 subgroup, which is 100% capable in this exercise 3, and the strategic capacity of the airports. For Heathrow, the tendency is similar. The values are lower. We are looking here of delay values of 20 minutes. Here reached 6 minutes at the worst situation. The best result is again obtained for exercise 3 with 5% of flight capable. And in not congested airport as Madrid, the influence of the prioritization is practically irrelevant. The improvement for the capable flights is less than a minute with respect to the global with the global numbers. Looking at the results for the two scenarios where we include the external disturbance, in this scenario we reduce the capacity of 6 airports in Turkey by 50% during 8 hours. What we represent in the figure is that here we have the value of the capable and at the side the value of capable side in nominal conditions. Red for capable, blue for non-capable, and green for the global numbers.
Andres, just to be sure, the earthquake scenario was that you closed the airport for 2 hours, right?
Okay, yes, I closed the airport. Yes, I missed the effects. There's a mistake here. I closed the 6 airports by 2 hours at noon. This is the effect of the other scenario. Sorry. What we could see here is that only for capable flights and in a scenario where the capable percentage is low, exercise 1, which is 18%, and exercise 2, which is 33%, it is possible to reach the values of the indicators in the nominal conditions, although the overall delay and the delay for non-capable flights are heavily penalized with respect to the nominal conditions. We assume that in exercise 1 and 2, the capable flights demand are below the reduced capacity of the network. So once this demand has reached the reduced capacity, we suppose that there will be an intermediate scenario between exercise 2 and 3, the capable flights start to compete between them for the available slots and the delay indicators get worse. Only in those scenarios where the capable flights are below the reduced capacity, we obtain good results. This is the effect of the other exercise. Here we have an ATC system failure in London area. 6 airports were closed, were half their capacity reduced 50% during 8 hours, and the best results are obtained for the exercise 5, where there are the most number of capable flights. It's not the same as in the other. Looking at the conclusions, the best results are obtained looking at the global numbers for exercise 3, where 50% of the flights are capable. The improvements for the scenarios where higher percentage capabilities are not significant. There are benefits for congested airports. It could be logical because the capable flights could use an extra 10% of capacity, so at the end they obtain a benefit. For regular and regional airlines, the best results are for exercises with higher percentage of capable flights, This is not happen for low-cost airlines. This has to be, or this has to be related with the nature of their operations that are more concentrated in an area. It's not the case for the low-cost or point-to-point airlines. The fourth bullet is we have a statistical analysis, and we reach that the difference between the results for each scenario are statistically significant, but these differences are not statistically big. That means that at the network level, the effect of the prioritization criteria will not disturb global performance. Other conclusion is that probably a localized application of the strategy in the most congested airport, and maybe during specific periods of time, could even be more beneficial. So we have applied here the strategy for all the network and all the airports and during all the time. Probably if we look to apply the strategy only for specific airports and for specific periods of time, could obtain better results. And as a conclusion, the proactive prioritization on the ground to airlines which have invested in capabilities is not only beneficial for them, we could demonstrate, but also for the global network. We obtain better performance indicator for the global network. And these benefits are bigger in congested airports and for airlines which used to operate in these areas. The best results, as I told you, are obtained with a fleet which is half capable and half not capable. Above this threshold, there are not significant operational improvements. And that's all. I'm open to any question you would like to ask me.
Thank you. Do we have questions here in Brittany? Nadine?
I've noted a number of hypotheses.
Yeah.
That I would like to clarify. Mm-hmm. Why do you say that the private airlines are likely not to be capable?
It's just a simulation hypothesis. We have decided not to consider them as capable. Just to
because it's reputed that the business aviation in particular would be the first to be most technical.
Probably, technological. Yes. But we also look at the school flights or training flights that they used to be with all airlines. And the problem we have here is that the number of flights on this subgroup is so small that if we want to split, we do not have any criteria to split it. In the other groups, we have the airline, and we could put same number of flights or airline in each one. In this group, we don't have any clue for them. So we decided to put it as non-capable, but it's just a simulation hypothesis.
I have another question. You seem to consider that the prioritization, in order to allow prioritization, the airport should have to keep 10% of their capacity. So congested airport like Heathrow would put 10% of its capacity aside for the most capable.
No. It's not.
So I did not understand really that hypothesis.
What we assume is that as they are capable flights, they have advanced equipment, they could, for example, reduce their separation in the arrival flow, and they could increase the capacity by 10%.
Okay.
Maybe the 10% is a very high number, or
yes.
Very high, but yes. Probably it's a very high number, but we don't know, have any, we check the literature, we try to find any value to apply, but we don't know how, and we decide to include this extra 10%, but only in the situations where the airport is yet congested, not as a global issue. So we do not increase the capacity of Heathrow by 10%, only if Heathrow reach a congestion situation and they need to increase the capacity by 10%, always comparing with the nominal capacity. We also consider that the nominal capacity could be overcome in stress situation because it's just a number of public number, but it could be overcome. So we consider that for this stress situation and only for capable flight that it could reduce the separation in the arrival flow, this capacity could be obtained. Yeah.
Just a small remark on that. So we have done almost exactly that, but we didn't study the gain the way you did. But we have had an exercise where we reduced capacity at a congested airport, and then we let some aircraft have a capability of landing with shorter separation. Mm. The 10%, I can't judge the 10%, but this was in a low visibility condition, so the capacity is much reduced already. And the other point is that at Heathrow, they already have the MLS system where they allow British Airways aircraft to land on the departure runway in certain conditions during the peak hours. So at Heathrow, at least, they look at this.
An empirical proof of this performance benefit. It's good to know. Yep.
And the last point, not commenting the results, but just in the, I think I have understood that the way you measure delay is below 5 minutes or something.
Yeah.
Yes. We have received a comment recently. It's just for you and in general for work package. That the in César it should be 3 minutes instead of five. Okay. Just we should consider the 3 minutes.
The reason why we use 5 minutes here is because the time window we are using for splitting or for dividing the simulation is 5 minutes. So it's easier for us to calculate these 5 minutes or this delay about 5 minutes than 3 minutes. But this is variable, so we could use a 3 minute time window and calculate the values for that.
Brian, you had a question?
During your description of the model itself, just one question. You mentioned the use of complexity.
Yeah.
You mentioned that you take into account complexity. I assume you're taking that account in the flying period, in the tactical period of it. How are you doing it if you haven't got trajectories, if you're not looking at interflight?
We use complexity as we model the network as a complex network. We model the nodes, or we model the airport as nodes. We assume that the edges that are joining the nodes are these flights that are flying. So those two nodes are joined if there are a flight between them.
Okay, so it's an airport by a node by node complexity measure.
Yeah, and we apply this uncertainty. We use a free route, but we not use the constant flight time, because we apply an uncertainty parameter for this flight time.
Okay.
Do we have more questions here from Brittany, Mark?
I understand you developed your own simulation engine.
Yeah.
Was there no tool available to do this kind of simulation? Did you need to develop your own tool?
Yeah, we need to develop our own tool. We have a tool developed for the first part of the NEWO project, and what we did is to adapt this tool to this.
Even before in NEWO itself, did you look at available tools?
No. We decided from the beginning to use our own tool, or to develop our own.
It is actually a tool that isn't developed for the project. It's been used in STFA.
Yeah.
And it was developed together with Inaxis.
I used it in previous studies as well, together with them.
More questions here? Shall we come to you, Olivia and Stella? Do you have questions over there?
Yes, we have quite a few questions. So I'll let Olivia start and then I will ask you some questions. Yes, hello. This here from the SJU for the rest of the audience. I wanted to ask about the way that the capable flights were modeled. One thing is about what's the disturbance parameter that changed. So what is the value of those three sigma of one compared to the other?
When we apply this three sigma rule at the end, we find out that this three sigma is effect is almost negligible, because the part of the curve that we are disregarding is very, very, very small. This is an assumption that we take, and we should be more constrained here, or more constrained, and use not maybe a three sigma rule, but a sigma rule, probably.
What are those disturbances? Are they like turnaround disturbances, or is that in-flight variability?
For disturbance, I have explained in the presentation. Let me show you again. These four parameters are the ones who model this internal disturbance. A1, A2, so one is for the turnaround phase, one is for the taxi out phase, the third is for flying phase, and the fourth is for the taxi in phase. And in the execution phase, we apply each one to each flight in the moment they correspond. So a parameter time before the flight reaches its estimated of block time, we apply A1. A parameter time before takeoff time, we apply A2. a parameter time before the flight starts to take off. We applied B1 and parameter time also before the flight lands, we applied C1.
So sorry, for a capable flight, everything would be reduced in the same rate. So you would be having a less taxi out variability and less flying time variability.
That's the key.
I was just wondering what kind of capability you were having in mind for this.
We treat the capable as an attribute, and what we try to do is to think which kind of advantages we could give to this capable flight, not going inside the which is the capability which is behind, which kind of advantage we can give to these flights. So there are three aspects. One is the prioritization of departures, the way we order the flights. The second one is the reduction on the variability when we apply this internal disturbance. So at the end, what we do is to cut all these tails for the capable flights. We concentrate the disturbance in the central part of the distribution. And the third issue is the extra 10% of capacity for arrival capable flights in congested situations. So these three effects are analyzed at the same time. It's true that since these three effects has been applied to all the exercises and at the same time, it's very difficult to know what effect or what consequence has any of the effects at the end. But
it would seem, because of the conclusion that it's only so the main effect is on congested areas, that probably the 10% capacity would be the most. So I'm thinking that maybe that's the main, so that you can actually put them closer together. So I'm thinking, for instance, as an example of a capability, you would say GBUS equipment, like a little bit like they do today with MLS at Heathrow.
Yeah.
But there is kind of a caveat for, I would say, for the way it's modeled, in the sense that if you have, even if you don't do any prioritization before departure, you will, you know, according to the fleet capability, you will get at the end a number of GBUS aircraft, say, so capable aircraft, and you will still be able to put them closer, right? Mm-hmm. So you would still be counting, like, statistically on a, maybe not 10%, say, if you have whatever fleet capability you have, you could actually, depending on your demand, just allocate more or less capacity depending on the traffic mix that you are expecting, even on an hourly basis, so that your capacity is 50 and then it can be 55 if you have so many GBUS without necessarily prioritizing them. So that's a kind of a thing that has been left. So you wonder how much of this is kind of lost in the assumption, right?
Yeah.
Thinking of this capability, but maybe for this is the capability I put in my mind. Maybe there are other capabilities that wouldn't have this such clear an effect. But so what I'm trying to say is, even if you don't prioritize, if you get 50% of your fleet with GBUS, you still get a capacity increase. So you would still be getting some network benefit. So that would be another type of comparison. But that's only with the second type of modeling.
Mm-hmm. Probably, yes.
So this is a business case for GBUS, for example.
For example, could be an example.
I was thinking, but maybe you, I was wondering if you had other capabilities in mind when you were doing these Sigma.
It's impossible to identify which aircraft are capable or not capable, or which capability has the aircraft from the traffic sample we have it, or from the data we have it. We decided to simulate or to fake the capability attribute by ourselves, and we do not have in mind any special capability, any special equipment or any special training for the crew. We try to consider the aircraft as capable as a concept.
So did you compare different, for example, for the regional airline scenarios, did you assume that all aircraft are the same or different type of aircraft you took under consideration?
No, we do not go through different type of aircraft. The aircraft are capable or not capable.
Okay.
This is the only attribute we use it.
Thank you. Understood.
You're welcome.
Stella, you said you had many questions.
Well, not many, two more questions. It was on the model characteristics. And my question here was more like a more research question. What were the constraints of using stochastic simulation model for achieving your objectives as a project?
The stochastic simulation is because we are applying this internal disturbance and we are applying based on distribution. So we are not applying the same disturbance in each run. So we need to do a stochastic simulation.
Yeah, but what were the weaknesses you experienced when you were applying it?
In the first period, what we learned to do is that we need to do a significant number of these runs or the simulations to be statistically significant. And okay, this is a drawback in the sense that we have to calculate before the number of runs, and normally or sometimes the number of runs are so high that your simulation time is longer than you expected or than you have planned. But this is the only drawback.
Okay, and then my last question is, based on the results you have identified from your projects and the research activities, what are your recommendations on future research domains or in the future long-term research?
Say, I would like to do some similar studies, but trying to isolate better the effects and the causes. Maybe applying this effect one by one, or maybe as Olivia has said, only taking into account this unspecific capability and simulating what happens if this specific capability and analyzing its performance benefit. What happens if the fleet is equipped with this capability or a percentage of the fleet? I think this kind of studies opens the door to do this kind of simulations, more specific simulations, look at a more specific equipage types, and could be a good start for cost-benefit analysis of this kind of capabilities.
Or so, would you reflect this in your final project report, like other section of that?
I will do it.
Okay, thank you on my side. Okay. Olivia, do you have some more questions?
No, that's all. Thank you.
Thank you. Nadine, you had another question?
No, I just wanted to see the conclusions again.
But I think this is a good conclusion or a good stay or good way forward to try to analyze more specific capabilities, looking at the performance benefit that has been identified for these capabilities and assuming a percentage of flights having this capability.
Your capabilities are, I understand, generic.
But yeah, it's generic.
I mean, at some point you have to connect the capabilities to some technology or some developments in CESAR, right?
Yes.
So that would be... Presumably after 5 years of CESAR, there are indications as to what kinds of benefits are available from specific technology.
Mm-hmm.
So you should maybe focus, I don't know if you've got any follow-up, focus the capabilities on actual potential improvements.
Yeah, that's a good continuation or point to continue with the study, looking at the real performance benefit, not assumptions or for specific capabilities, and assuming that a number of flights or a number of airlines have adopted this capability.
Okay, more questions? Okay, well, thank you very much.
Thank you to everybody.
Thank you for
the questions. Thank you.
Thank you.
Stella, do you want to stay connected for a little while and discuss
yes.
Project yeah. management aspects?
Yes. Yeah.